Shall we sing our first carol? Liz is playing for most of them, and then Douglas and Mary are going to accompany two of them on the guitar and the recorder. So that'll be nice. Thank you, you two. Right. Now, the first carol we're going to sing shows the way we're holding this thing. Very informal, very happy and go lucky, and let's forget our troubles for a while. And we're going to start by singing, "Come and Join the Celebration." Bit about the shepherds and the wise men, and after that we're going to sing the angel Gabriel, and I can give you the number of that if I can find the right piece of paper. It's worse than church, all these bits of paper. The angel Gabriel is 139 in the hymn book, if you're looking. Can we just sort of start with a little prayer? It's only a short one, and then we're going to go on and listen to a bit about the shepherds. So let's have the prayer, the guiding star. Lord, the sight of the guiding star brought hope, courage, and joy to those who had journeyed to find you. When our journey seems long, when hope seems far away, when our courage is failing, fill us with faith and trust. Shine your light on our fears. Lift our hearts with your joy. Help us to recognize you in our brothers and sisters throughout the world. Show us how we can work together so that we may all come to share in the life promised to us by Jesus, the Savior of us all. Amen. Now, that last hymn we sang told how the shepherds came from the stables and the wise men came afar. And it's always puzzled me that every nativity scene you see everywhere, the shepherds and the wise men are all in that stable together, along with all the animals. We're getting very full. And I sort of thought, I don't think they all got there together. So I just wrote down a few words as I thought about it. As the shepherds saw the glorious light, the wise men saw the star. As shepherds heard the angels' call, the wise men travelled far. The shepherds came running down the hill. The wise men's way was longer. As the shepherds found the place of birth, the wise men's hope grew stronger. The shepherds left, their hearts were light, and the wise men travelled nearer. The shepherds rejoiced and told their friends, and the wise men's star grew clearer. As the shepherds watched their flocks by night, the wise men found the stable. And the shepherds and the wise men knew God's son was in that cradle. Right. We're now going to sing the Angel Gabriel. 139. Sing Silent Night next, and I think Doug and Mary, this is one you're going to accompany us on. Silent Night, and it was very silent, but you know there is another version of that night which you're going to hear. You've probably all heard it before, but here we go. It's called Jesus Christmas Party. There was nothing the innkeeper liked more than a good night's sleep, but that night there was a knock at the door. No room, said the innkeeper. But we're tired and have travelled through night and day. There's only the stable round the back. Here's two blankets. Sign the register. So they signed, Mary and Joseph. Then he shut the door, climbed the stairs, got into bed and went to sleep. But then later, there was another knock at the door. Excuse me, I wonder if you could lend me a smaller blanket. Ah, there, one smaller blanket, said the innkeeper. Then he shut the door, climbed the stairs, got into bed and went to sleep. But then a bright light woke him up. That's all I need, said the innkeeper. Then he shut the door, climbed the stairs, drew the curtains, got into bed and went to sleep. But then, you've guessed it, there was another knock at the door. We are three shepherds. Well, what's the matter? Have you lost your sheep? We've come to see Mary and Joseph. Round the back, said the innkeeper. He shut the door, climbed the stairs, got into bed and went to sleep. But then there was yet another knock at the door. The evening hasn't finished yet, has it? We are the three wise men. We've come round the back, said the innkeeper crossly. Then he slammed the door, climbed the stairs, got into bed and went to sleep. There's another noise. It wasn't a knock at the door, no. There was a chorus of singing that woke him up. Right, that does it. So he got out of bed, he stomped down the stairs, he threw open the door, went round the back, stormed into the stable and was just about to speak when, shh, whispered everybody, the baby's asleep. You'll wake him up. Baby, said the innkeeper. Yes, a baby has this night been born. Oh, said the innkeeper, looking crossly into the manger. And just at that moment, suddenly, his anger seemed to fly away. Oh, said the innkeeper, isn't he lovely? In fact, he thought he was so special, he woke all the guests at the inn. So nobody got much sleep that night, but I hope the baby Jesus did. No, I think what we ought to do now really is get rid of the pandemic elephant that's in this Zoom with us. We all know it's there, so let's just take a little moment to think about it. We know at the moment, unlike the Holy Family, we can't make the journey to all our friends and that this year, especially after yesterday's news. It's very sad. We can't all go home and not sign the register, but meet all our friends and that. So the lockdown is there, not getting any better. And I'd like to read you a poem, which I got right at the beginning of the pandemic, actually. And it's written by Pam Ayres, and it tells about the first lockdown we had. But I think it's all the same, isn't it? Not getting much better. Anyway, here it is, our pandemic poem. I'm normally a social girl. I love to meet my mates. But lately with the virus here, we can't go out the gates. You see, we are the oldies now. We need to stay inside. As we haven't been seen for a while, they think we're upped and died. They'll never know the things we did before we got this old. There wasn't any Facebook, so not everything was told. We may seem sweet old ladies and gentlemen, but we were young once. If they only knew the truth, we grew up in the 60s. There were sex and drugs and rock and roll, the pill and miniskirts. We smoked, we drank, we partied, and were quite outrageous flirts. Well, that's all except me, of course. But now, we can't go anywhere. And we've turned into someone's mum, someone's wife, a nana. Who on earth did we become? We didn't need this change of pace because our lives were full. But to bury us before we're dead is like red rag to a bull. So here you find me stuck inside for many weeks and maybe more. I finally found myself again, then I had to close the door. It didn't really bother me. I while away the hour. I'd bake for all the family, but we were running out of flour. So let us all drink to lockdown, to recovery and health, and hope this awful virus doesn't decimate our wealth. We'll all get through our crisis and be back to join our mates. Just hoping I'm not far too wide to fit through those pearly gates. Right, thank you, Pam, for that. Now we're going to have the Calypso Carol, which you all know. See him lying on a bed of straw. And I think Doug and Mary are doing this again. Yep. And I've lost my list with hymn numbers on.
We've got a backing for that.
Because that was the manger scene, and that with thinking back, I'm sure you've all been there, all you parents, the school nativity play. You all remember them? Mm-hmm. Or have you all got over the embarrassment of all that is? I'm just going to read you a little excerpt from the nativity play at a village school. Other people have Christmas. Village school teachers have nativity plays. From early November and through to the late dark days of December, the village school teacher feels that this year's nativity is probably the most unholy thing to be conceived and produced. That parents normally indulgent at the efforts of their offspring will not be able to ignore this year's fiasco. That this is the very last nativity play she will attempt. That she is in the wrong profession altogether, and next July she will leave and be a shorthand typist. However, the term progresses, and as December begins, the clothes horses are brought out of the headmistress's adjoining house, and the by now traditional scenery is touched up and pinned onto them. No one thinks of asking the headmistress how she airs her clothes during December. Villages headmistresses bear their discomforts at this time with a seemly stoicism. An incredibly sardonic donkey peers over the scenery as a tomato box on legs, complete with 15-year-old straw, but as yet no inhabitant. The dressing up box is opened. The giggling angels are fitted up with grubby robes and they'll take them home under their arms for mother to add a little biological whiteness to the little scene. The shepherds tighten their dressing gown cords and wince as the hand towels are bound round their heads with a vicious pull. The wise men empty their mother's tea caddies for gold and frankincense, and the vicar is approached once more for his ebony box for the myrrh. Their crowns are made from old jewellery and copious gold paint. A huge spangled star is made, which, lo, they will behold in the east. Well, at least one will point and say, lo, the others will be grinning vacantly at the front seats. The angel Gabriel is bigger than the other angels and therefore of a different breed, she feels. She has to be dressed in the redoubtable school cleaner's nightie, which is of cream nun's veiling and made when people knew how to run and fell. Fresh tinsel is brought from the Christmas orientated shops in the outside world. Last year's is tarnished and would be bad for the angel's image. Rehearsals move slowly. Joseph is often away at the speech clinic and has a script cunningly composed of words without the letter S. The angel Gabriel herself is away with what is reported as a bladder complaint, despite her superiority. The little shepherds cannot manage their crooks. Everyone catches cold. Even the girl who is playing Mary sniffs and claps a hanky to her nose as she is asked to lean over the tomato box. Dawn breaks on the last Thursday before the Christmas holidays. Night must fall. The teacher tells herself comfortably, and the shorthand is coming on well. After lunch, the boys get out the chairs in rows for their mothers, aunties, grannies, and lots of other people like the tribe of Israel to sit on. The baby doll is laid in the straw for the first time. Everyone is ordered to the outside lavatories for the last time, as they are warned severely. The sob of dressing, pinning and pulling up things begin. The whole cast is lined up at the door, ready to file into what is inevitably their final tableau. The teacher surveys the squirming line and cannot remember ever having seen such a motley bunch of shepherds, such a shifty-eyed, sniffing pair of innkeepers, such a miserable Madonna, surely the most retarded of wise men. This moment is the least of the school teacher's worries as she wonders what they're going to do. But as the music begins, the angel Gabriel is allowed up to the lavatories by special dispensation owing to the nature of her complaint. And the teacher breathes a sigh of relief as she sees her rushing back to the stage. And as the music dies away, the screens are removed by two stalwart boys who have been standing behind them waiting for the countdown. The clear voice of one of the bigger girls hangs on the air of the unusually quiet schoolroom. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth. The words of the authorized Bible, so maligned and meaningless over the past few weeks, ring out again, this time clearly and truly subtly enhanced by the soft local accent. School teacher feels a relaxation in her heart, and she knows, as she knows this at a certain amount every year, that this will be the fitting climax to the country year. The children are probably the best she's had, she thinks profoundly, and is privileged to be able to work for them in their short lives. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. Enter the star, which lo, they are all looking at. The moment is crystallized into a private significance for each person watching. The screens are drawn together for the last time, and the miracle which happens every year has taken place once more. Yes, privilege is not too strong a word, thinks the teacher proudly. Moments like these are possibly not experienced by shorthand typists. And of course, we're missing all that this year, although there have been some wonderful ones on television, haven't they? Some of the things the schools and that have thought up have been really impressive and very encouraging to us all. We're going to sing our little town of Bethlehem. 1, 4, 5. Say that instead of a prayer at the end, I thought we'd sing ourselves out with joy to the world. Let us sing the words as a thank you for the wonderful world we feel is missing at the moment, but with the complete confidence that soon we will be visiting our families and friends, holidaying where we wish, maybe even over in America, Bob and May, Mary, and that we will be back in our beloved church singing this carol again with those we love. And we shall sing it with great gusto. Look out, Friary, you might need a new roof. Happy Christmas, everybody, as we sing ourselves out with joy to the world, and keep the joy in your hearts. Bless you all. Happy Christmas.
God has come, let us receive a King, let ever-ending awe prepare in Rome, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Sounding joy. that's all been best aground, for sins and sorrows know, our Lord of pain and death are bound. He makes his blessings flow, he makes his blessings flow, he makes, his blessings flow. And wonders, wonders of his love.
Well done, that was lovely. That was great. Now, of course, who's going to bring the cups of tea round?
Yeah,
here you go.
We could all go and sit around and chat.
It's a nice cold one for lunch. You know, there's never...
It's empty. It's no good. Empty.
I just want to say, this has been so wonderful. I just want to have you all.
Lovely. Yes.
Merry Christmas.
And the same to you. It's lovely. Yes, we do miss you at this time of year. We used to have such fun, didn't we? We all had such fun at Christmas, and we've got lovely memories to think of. And
we miss you all the time, not just Christmas.
Thank you.